Now, something that all of you would have noticed in our previous session, you noticed when we were talking about emotions, everyone was quite alert, quite awake, not very shut down at all, pretty open. Everyone was listening quite intently. As soon as we started talking about this particular subject, the world's definition of God, all of a sudden, many of you became very shut down. Quite a number of you fell asleep. And many of you just felt like fighting off tiredness and so forth. And I want to just address that before we begin the second half. Otherwise, you'll all be asleep by the time I'm finished. There are a lot of Christian spirits who are with us today who are in quite a deal of anger about what I'm saying. And many of you, when you have anger projected at you, you just want to shut down. You just want to go away. And the key is to be open rather than shutting down. With regard to the spirits, next Thursday there is a little tiny mediumship group that we've set up. And my suggestion is, and I'll just say this for the spirits' benefit, my suggestion is if you have issues with what I'm saying to the group today, instead of unlovingly oppressing the group with anger and rage, the better thing to do for you spirits would be to come along and talk to me. I'm the person who's saying all these things. Come and talk to me about how angry and upset you feel about what I'm saying, and we can talk on that Thursday when we've got that mediumship organised, rather than dumping your anger and rage on the group that's present. Many of the Christian spirits are still awaiting the day of judgment. So they still have very, very strong beliefs in the spirit world that are causing them to remain in the first dimension of the spirit world. And some of them are even in the hells of the spirit world. And many of them are still awaiting the time that Jesus comes. And therefore, they feel I cannot be Jesus because I haven't come in the manner that they have expected, that I would come and bring them as my angels back to earth and go through this process and that they believe will occur. Now, obviously, this will never occur. And me stating that is causing them to feel quite a lot of anger and rage. My stating also that the Bible's definition of God is incorrect is quite confronting for them, because it also then puts into question whether the Bible is God's word or not, and many of them have believed they've been following the Bible. Unfortunately, the condition of darkness they're in is not a reflection of whether they followed the Bible or not, but rather a reflection of whether they had love in their souls or not. And the condition of love is determining their current condition, not the condition of how much they believed the truth or not. So unfortunately for many of them, they think that all they needed to do was believe the truth, and it didn't matter how loving they were. But it does matter how loving you are. And if you look at the Bible's words of some of my words in the first century, you will see I was constantly referring to how loving a person was and how important it was for their future. So that's something that for them to bear in mind. I just wanted to say that to help alleviate some of the pressure many of you feel to go to sleep this afternoon. So I'm also trusting that it's not because the subject matter is boring. Many of you have this idea where you already know what God is. And so the subject matter sometimes feels a little like we're revising something or something like that. However, I put to you this one basic truth. If you know what God is, then you would already be at one with God. It's an interesting way of looking at it, isn't it? If you really know what God is, you would now, right at this moment, be at one with God. So the reality that is that all of us here are not yet at one with God. So therefore, we do not know what God is. And this is why it's essential to cover the subject. Because without covering the subject, we will never see why we don't know what God is. And can you see already that one of the primary reasons why we don't know what God is because we're imposing our emotions towards our parents, towards God. And it's the and also we're imposing the world's belief systems towards God, which limits us. Now, intellectually, you and I can reason to the end of time about God, and you still won't know what God is. Because unless you can feel God's love entering you, and it's God's love entering you that allows you to understand God. So God's love is the thing that opens your soul into having a capacity to understand God, as well as understand yourself and understand the universe. That's the subsequent side benefits of understanding God. And that's why I use the words in the first century that if you sought first God's love, all these other things will be added to you. You see, once you can understand more about God, you will automatically understand more about everything else. Because understanding God is the most difficult in the sense of it is an infinite process of coming to understand God, and it's the most complex process of coming to understand God. Everything I've personally ever discovered in the last 2,000 years has always been less... There's always been a feeling in me that I'm trying to work out the right way to say this now. If you can understand God, you can understand everything else. You understand that intellectually? If you can understand God, you can get everything else. You can investigate everything else and still not understand God. But the more you get to understand God, the more knowledge of everything else automatically comes to you as a result of your understanding of God. Because the different complexities of understanding God, if I can use that term, and it's not the right term, and that's why I was sort of fumbling with the word, but I can't find another English word to describe what I'm trying to say, unfortunately. The different complexities involved in understanding God help you understand the rest of the universe. What's the word, do you think, babe? You need to use a mic. Yeah, because it's all right.
It's because... once you understand God's nature and the way God's love governs everything else in the universe, it's very easy to interface with anything else in the universe because you see God's logic in it. Is that what you're trying to say?
Sort of, but it's not the full extent of what I'm trying to say. And
I don't know how to say it either.
Yeah, and I don't know if anyone will get what I'm trying to say anyway, so I might give that up anyway. Sorry. But, I think all of you get the underlying gist, but there is a... as I said to Dion in the break, if you imagine the universe like this, it's an ever-expanding universe of which we are in a galaxy, in a little solar system, in a little planet. And there's us there. I'll draw us a little there. We're a bit bigger than Earth at this point, but anyway, you get the idea. And it's been proven, of course, that the universe is ever expanding. It's expanding outwards, traveling above light speeds outwards generally. Now, if God was a part of the universe, then if this universe did not exist, that would mean God did not exist. And I put to you that that is also illogical. Like, for example, when you create a car, you exist before the creation of the car. And you can jump in the car or get out of the car, The car is a separate thing to you. And I put to you that the universe is the same is that as that. In other words, that the universe is a creation of God and not God herself. And that being the case, God exists even when the universe did not exist. God continued to exist. And it's through a process that man is starting to understand the beginnings of through investigation at this point in time, that God created the universe, and then things started to be created within the universe itself, inside of this system, if you like. That being the case, God has to be not a part of that system in the sense that God existed before that system got created. So you know how a lot of scientists are coming up with the idea now of through scientific proof, that we are all joined together, even subatomically. We're all joined together. While that is true, that does not mean we are all the same entity. And secondly, while that is true, it does not mean that God is joined with us in the same manner. It's an illogical extension to believe so, because the reality is before this universe existed, God existed. And so therefore, God must be larger and different to the universe itself. And there are still in the universe, we look at the physical universe, but there is the spiritual universe, which you cannot see at this point in time, but which also is ever expanding. And every time a new dimension is created through a jump in love, there is a whole new universe created as well. And God existed before the creation of that universe as well. So while that universe is a part of God's energy, in other words, God's energy is flowing through and into that universe, it does not mean that God is that universe, and it does not mean we are God. They are two illogical extensions of what we observe. Now, what I'm feeling a lot of times when I talk about logic, there is a struggle in many of you with the logical extensions. And if you can for a moment just consider that is because of different emotions you have from your childhood about logic. Many of us have a block to logic and a block to mathematics and a block to science. And a lot of those blocks to logic, mathematics and science are related to emotions related to your parents, and particularly your fathers. Right? But they're also related to the blocks regarding learning. And how much you've been made fun of when you were learning. How much you've been humiliated and punished when you were learning. And this process of different emotional injuries that are gathered through our lifetime causes us to be very shut down emotionally towards different aspects of learning. When you release all of these emotional damage, you are now completely open to all aspects of learning. So those of you who are not very attracted to mathematics will find yourself becoming more so. Just as those who are not very attracted to music will find yourself becoming more so, and so forth. Because as we release the blockages within our soul is able then to absorb information from the universe and absorb all of the information that's available rather than a limited type of information that's available. Does that make sense to everyone? So if you can remember that this concept that we are God and, you know, and that God's energy flows through us and all that, some of these concepts, like that God's energy flows through us, is true, but that doesn't make us God, because there could be a transfer mechanism that allows energy to flow from God to us. We could still be two separate individuals, two separate entities. So while we make a statement that God's energy flows through us, it's not a logical extension then to believe that I am God or God is me. Can you see that? You see, this is where we as mankind have got to be very careful. This is what religion has done. They've looked at one thing, then they've made some statements which they then turn into dogma, into what they believe to be truth. And we've got to be very careful doing this in our progression. This is not the way to truth. Remember, truth is an ever-expanding and universal expansion process. What I am saying to you now will need to be revised. Not may need to be revised, will need to be revised. It is the level of truth we know at this point in time. And any point in time, there is going to be a growth in truth, and we need to get used to this idea. We need to get used to the idea that none of us can actually say dogmatically, this is the direct truth about this particular thing without there being more knowledge available. Now, there are many subjects in the universe that spirits in the spirit world and in the last 2,000 years in the spirit world, we have exhaustively experimented with and feel a very, very high degree of certainty about. One of those is the reception of divine love. There is literal proof that this is the truth in many billions of spirits now. So there is proof that divine love is available to all humanity and through a process, the process of becoming born again. There is that proof available. As soon as one person did it, then there was proof available. And this is what we need to bear in mind with all of our discoveries of truth. With every discovery of truth that has ever occurred on the planet or in the spirit world, there was always a first person who discovered it. And secondly, once that person discovered it, it can be established as truth to the degree that we understand it. And that's what we need to bear in mind with all truth. So creating a book, which is then said to be the whole of God's truth, nothing but the truth, and nothing can be added or taken away from it, is actually now precluding the discovery of additional truth. What it's trying to do is fit a universal and infinite cosmos into a book and limit it, which is a physical impossibility. So this is something we need to bear in mind in our own progression. And this is why we need to be open to our connection to God, because that's our connection to God that is going to help us get more and more knowledge and more wisdom, more and more understanding, and more importantly than all of those three things, more love. So if we can bear that in mind when we're analysing these things, it will help us a lot. And it will also, if the Spirit's with us, could bear that in mind too, that logically, the universal cosmos, which is infinite in nature, and therefore God must be even more so, if there could be such a term, can't fit in to a limited 2,000 or 1,000 page book. And we can't expect it to. And if you expect it to, you are already out of harmony with the development of more truth within your own life. You're limiting yourself straight away. So we need to bear that in mind. All right, let's look at some other things about God. Remember, it's the world's definition of God that is now, right at this moment, defining your relationship with God. That's why we're going through this. Your relationship with God is being controlled by any unhealed emotions and any unhealed beliefs you have inside of yourself about God. And these unhealed emotions and unhealed beliefs within yourself about God came from the world in which you lived and very much so from the parents where you grew up. Now, your parents can be atheists and you still will have different beliefs about God that are erroneous. They could be agnostics. And you will still have different beliefs about God that are erroneous inside of your soul. And at some point, connecting with God will confront them. So let's look at some of the beliefs about God. 1 Timothy 6, verses 15 and 16 says this. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone is immortal, and who lives in unapproachable light, who no one can see or has seen or can see, to him be the honour and might forever. So it's basically saying, what about God? That God is the universal ruler, and that God is immortal, lives in a place that nobody else could actually survive in. Now, the reality is I believe most of those things. That God lives in a place that I personally could not survive in right now, and therefore lives in a place of far higher love than what I personally have received. But then there's this other scripture. So there's one scripture. There's this God who basically is a loving ruler of creation. And then there's this other scripture that says, that God will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of Lord Jesus. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of God. All right. So on one hand, we've got this God who is the blessed, loving ruler of creation. And on the other hand, this blessed, loving ruler of creation murders people as well. Now, logically, does that make much sense? It's quite confused, isn't it? Can we see again that the confusion between those two verses, which, by the way, are both in the New Testament of the Bible, not in the Old, and they're actually only two books apart. They're that many pages apart, just a few pages apart. Totally different contradictory statements about God. So what does the average church person do with this? They say, oh, well, that's not a contradiction about God. God is a ruler and God will punish the wicked. That's what we've got to accept. Now, the only reason why you would have a tendency to accept that is because you're angry with people and you want them punished. Is that not true? And what's happened just earlier is a group of Christian spirits came to us wanting people to be punished. They're waiting for the day of judgment because all the people who harmed them, they want punished. And they feel that if that doesn't happen, then they'll miss out on this beautiful feeling of having all the people who harmed them punished. And I know in the case of my own father feels very, very similar to this. He feels that he is a peaceable man. He would never go to war. At one stage before he was religious, he was in the army, but he got out of the army and in the army reserve, sorry, he was, and he got out of that, but now he would never go to war. Someone could put a gun to his head and say go to war and he would let himself be shot instead of going to war. That's my father. So he would classify himself to be a peaceable man. But when I talked to him about God not being a God of wrath or a God of punishment, he became enraged with me. Because he wants God to punish all the people that he wasn't allowed to punish. You see? Yeah.
AJ, I have not worked through my father's stuff, and I assume then that I'm wanting to punish him.
Wanting to punish your dad, yep.
Yeah, because, you know, what he did. Mm. So, logically, I'd say I don't believe in a punishing God. Is that really denying the fact that I probably see God as a punishing God?
Well, do you want your father to be punished?
If you ask me logically, I'd say no, but I think...
What's the feeling? Be honest with the feeling, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Who's going to do the punishing if you're not going to do it?
God.
Someone has to, right? So we're really expecting God to carry out acts of violence towards others. We want God to, in fact, so that we don't have to do it. So this emotion is in very many of us, right, where we would actually prefer to see somebody punish all the people that have hurt us in our life, and we can't do it ourselves because we know that would be wrong, so we want God to do it. Now, if we can't do it, see, this is again an extension of logic. If we can't do it ourselves because we know it would be wrong, then surely it would also be wrong for God to do it. That makes sense, logically. But we don't think that way because we want God to do it. So what we do is we impose this emotion of wanting the punishment of others upon God. So we say, yep, it's not up to us to punish God. Instead, it's up to us to punish others. Instead, we're going to wait for God to punish others. And in fact, there's a very verse in the Bible that actually says that, which I'll read to you a bit later, that is waiting for God to punish others. Tim?
Yeah, with what you're saying, it sort of seems to me like I've sort of been in and around a few religions recently, and a lot of Christians have said like they've felt a spirit or God prompt them to talk to me about certain things. And but by what you're explaining today, a lot of those prompts, it seems that God's prompting them to save them from God. Like,
exactly. Yeah. Does it sound like God would be doing that?
Yeah. Well,
not logically.
It's like chasing God, chasing his tail sort of
thing. So who's prompting them?
spirits, obviously.
Spirits who are also in the same belief system in the spirit world and who want to basically confront you somehow. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this is why you receive a lot of angry-based emotions from Christians oftentimes. Not all Christians are like that. There's some Christians that are very open, very loving, very considerate of others, and not judgmental or condemnatory. But unfortunately, there are also another group who are very unloving, very angry, very rageful, very condemnatory, and very judgmental and attacking. And one of the reasons why they are is because they are often quite overcloaked by spirits in the spirit world who are Christians who have the same judgmental emotions, the same kind of emotions of what was present during the Inquisition, for example, where they felt that they could oppress others through rage and anger and violence. Mm. Yep. Just straight behind. Thanks.
Oh, AJ, I just wanted to ask, I mean, I don't want to think God punishes, but what about if you throw in God's laws?
Ah, yeah, well, isn't that just an extension of God? Like, do God's laws punish? Let's ask that question.
Oh, do I think they punish? No, I don't think God's laws punish, but I think that there's God's laws, that if we break God's laws, mm-hmm. there's a consequence.
There is a consequence, but is that a punishment? Is a consequence the punishment?
Yes.
See, I'd argue no. The reason why I'd argue no is that the consequence is the direct result of the breaking of a law. It's not a punishment, it's just a direct result. It's like, would you say if a person fell off a roof and broke their arm when they hit the ground, would you say that was God's punishment for standing on the roof?
No.
Would you say it was God's punishment for falling off the roof?
No, I wouldn't.
So what would you say it was then?
I'd say that it was their law of attraction.
So in other words, they're to blame for breaking their arm.
Well, I guess the consequence is theirs because it's their law of attraction.
Yep.
But am I fooling myself by pretending to say that when really I'm still wanting punishment? I've still got that.
Yeah,
Christian.
I feel we've got to be very careful because we have a lot of these Christian beliefs from, these are multi-generational beliefs imposed. And even though many of us now are not Christian, we have many Christian beliefs going on inside of our soul still that we're basically imposing upon our life. The reality is when a law is broken, like God sets up laws for the protection and love of people. The reason why we have the law of gravity is quite simple. What is it? What is the law of gravity for? It sticks you to the earth, yeah. That's pretty handy, hey? Because what would happen if you flew off the earth? Eventually you'd get into a rare atmosphere where you'd be gasping for breath, and that would be pretty to feel pretty bad, wouldn't it? Particularly if you stayed there for a long period of time. You ask anybody who goes to Mount Everest, just 29,000 feet above the sea level, how they feel trying to breathe in that atmosphere. After a while, it's painful and exhausting, and they often spend very little time in that area without oxygen, right? Now, you go up another 50,000 feet above that, where are you getting into now? You're now starting to get on the edges of our what is it called, metosphere or whatever it is, and you're now getting on the borders of space, basically. Try breathing there. What happens there? No air at all. What happens when you're asphyxiated? You die. So God's law of gravity is a loving law to keep you on the ground. So that you don't fly off out into space the moment you imagine coming out of the womb and then flying off into space. Very short existence without the clarity. I know that sort of kind of... That puts some pretty funny images into your mind. I got that. So that's the law of gravity. The law of gravity is a law which consequences are loving. See, this is where we don't understand. The consequences are loving. It's only when we break the law in a manner that we do not understand that the consequence becomes painful. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, if I have the law of aerodynamics, I got to spell it properly. A-E-R-O. Right? If I have the law of aerodynamics on my side, now I understand how to... We're not breaking the law of gravity, are we? The law of gravity is still in play, but now we have found another law that operates on a higher level than the law of gravity that enables us to fly and enables the birds to fly, of course, and other things to other creatures to fly, enables us to fly because we understand the law. And that law is also loving.
What about the law of compensation?
That's also a very loving law. Very loving law. Because without compensation for things that have been done that have been unloving, there would be no correction on the soul that did the unloving act. And so the soul would never get into a happier state. So the law of compensation is another loving law. And one thing we need to understand about God is that all God's laws are loving. Now, if all God's laws are loving, none of them are for punishment purposes. They're all for a loving purpose, every single one of them. We just need to understand its purpose and what it's there for. None of us condemn the law of gravity as being an unloving law. Why did God create that? What's the problem with God? Unloving God making this gravity thing and whatever. Well, none of us complain about that. But as soon as we start talking about the spiritual laws, now we all start complaining. But they have exactly the same operation in that they are all loving. They all have a loving consequence. Now, when I break one of God's laws that operate upon my soul, and there are a class of laws that operate upon my soul, when I break one of them, there is a consequence upon my soul to help me work this way through what in my soul caused me to want to break that law. It's a bit like standing on the edge of a 10-story high building and feeling the urge to step off. Now, most of us would call that crazy if I didn't have a wing attached to my back of some kind. Most of us would call that crazy. We call that suicide. And yet, when it applies to God's other laws, the spiritual laws, we don't call that spiritual suicide. We call that God trying to control us. Do you understand the difference? Now, logically, if there is a consequence upon my soul for every act because the law is in place, and there needs to be laws in place because otherwise there would be anarchy, there needs to be laws in place, but the laws are in place. I have the choice inside of me to either break it or not break it. Now, sometimes I might break it inadvertently without there being a reason for myself. So in other words, I'm standing on the top of the building looking over and then somebody comes along and just gives me a push. Now, I haven't chosen to break it, but the consequence will be similar at the physical level. I'll probably die when I hit the ground, either way, whether I jumped or I was pushed. Either way, I don't condemn the law. I made the mistake, or the person who tried to murder me made the mistake. Does that make sense? We're still not condemning the law. We're not saying, oh, the law is unfair. What we're saying is that there is a consequence to the breaking of it. So if you can think that every one of God's laws must be loving, just assume they're all loving. And then you can also allow the fact that, yes, there will be a consequence on my soul, just like if I break the law of gravity, there's a consequence on my body. Then you also see that the consequences are not based around a punishing system, but rather a correctional system. Right? So if we stand on the edge of a roof and we fall off and hit the ground and break our arm, the next time we're on the roof, we're going to be a lot more careful about what we do, are we not? And unless we have another law at our side, then there's the law of aerodynamics, but there's other laws too. There's laws of anti-gravitational pull. There's laws of, like, scientific laws that we haven't even discovered yet that could help us avoid these situations. But we don't know how to use them just yet. So understanding that we have limitations at this point, we're pulled down by the law of gravity. So we're kept on the earth, and that's a loving thing, not an unloving thing. Otherwise, we'd be dead within moments of arrival. So we're in a loving environment. that God has created for the nurturing of our soul, but there are systems in place which will correct us if we try to break the loving environment. And if we look at every single law like that, we will have a large degree of understanding about God as a result.
Could I add? It's not even, like, the way I feel is God has geared the whole universe for us to learn love.
Yes.
So it doesn't even feel like a correction to me. It's a consequence that gives me an opportunity to learn love.
Yep.
And that's very different from punishment. Like, if I'm with a child and they do something that harms their soul, I can help them see the consequence so that they can learn love, or I can whack them, which is a punishment, and has nothing to do with, doesn't help them learn anything.
Yes, and God doesn't take that second action.
No, never. And I feel like there is this, we talked about it when we were in Armidale with the group, didn't we, about the law of attraction being a very loving law, and not just, it's not a, oh, something happened to you, it's your fault, it's your law of attraction.
Yeah.
There's a talk where you, in Melbourne, where you talk about that really beautifully, if people want to look at that, the different elements involved in one event in terms of the law of attraction and how it's loving to every person
for every
involved.
Single person involved. Yeah.
But I do feel it's a Christian hangover to go, that's your law of attraction.
And this is what I'm getting at. The world's definition of love, which has now entered us, and the world's definition of God that has now entered us, we now believe that God is not a God of love, but a God of punishment. And this is directly what this book is saying. It's saying to you, God is a God of love and a God of punishment at the same time. And I'm saying to you that such a thing is not possible. He's either one or the other, not both. He either is a God of love or he's a God of punishment, one or the other. The book itself says that he's both, that he's both. And in fact, there is then the implication that I can be both, that I can be a person of punishment and a person of love at the same time. And I suggest to you that that's also not possible, exactly the same limitation. So love is the defining factor of all of God's laws, and the trouble is our definition of God is based around a God of punishment, not a God of love. And so most of us even have the inflection in our own souls, even after we've learned the truth, we still have the feeling inside of us, most of us, that we're being punished with our law of attraction, for example, with God's law of attraction operating upon our soul, we feel like we're being punished rather than being corrected. We feel that we're getting punished rather than learning about love and learning about when we just broke the law of love. We feel we're being punished instead. We feel it's unjust most of the time, don't we? Like, how many times do we refer to an illness and think of it as an unjust illness? Pretty much all the time, don't we? And then how many times do you hear the person with an illness, everybody wants to pray for them? Why is that? Why does everybody want to pray for them? Now, I'm all for praying for them, but not to pray to alleviate their illness. Can you see why? Need to use a mic. With a hand. Thanks, Nina. Just straight behind her it is.
Taking away the consequence, the lesson they need to learn about love.
Yeah, we're taking away the consequence of something that's gone on inside of their soul that's been unloving to themselves that have caused the particular illness. So we're taking away their consequence. We're asking God to take away the consequence without dealing with its cause. Now, God's going to go, I'm sorry, but I created the cause. Like, I created this relationship because of a loving rule. How can I then do what you ask? I can only do what you ask if the person decides to see the unloving rule being broken. That's the only way I can do what you ask. That's the only way, in fact, that a proper healing can take place. So again, it's all about, you know, we feel that sickness is punishment. This is why we have so much judgment about somebody getting sick. You know, historically, whenever you got sick, you know what they used to say? That it was God's wrath upon you. And a lot of us still feel that, as if it is. And it's not. But we feel it is. And this is why we even have so much judgment about our own sicknesses, because we feel that it's somehow God's wrath, and it's not. Yeah? If we just watch out for the camera there. Thank you.
I'm just wondering if you can heal a child without the parents wanting to look at any of their emotions.
Certainly you can. The child has free will. So of course you can heal the child, but it doesn't mean that the child isn't going to reabsorb the same emotional condition that caused its illness. So the healing might be temporary rather than permanent, depending on what the child absorbs after that period of time. Yeah. Jen?
So this is a question from spirits from the other side.
Yep.
Who don't know that whether they've experienced love or not.
Mm-hmm.
And their question is, how do they unbelieve? How do they break down the web that they're in, that they've believed, when...
Well,
the question is, how do they unbelieve?
Yep, I get the question. Well, the first thing is that if they question whether they've ever received love or not, then they've probably never received love. The second thing is that how do you unbelieve? Well, this is the difficulty we face. The difficulty we face is that every belief that enters us that's false enters us through an emotional process. It enters us connected to some emotion or belief associated usually with our environment and particularly with our parents. So to unbelieve something means to give up the emotional connection between the belief and our desire to have it remain. And that is a difficult process for many. That's why many will actually go to war rather than do that, because it can be such a painful process. So to unbelieve, we have to have the ability to learn to experience our own pain rather than perpetrate pain onto others. And that's what is going to be required of every single false belief that's in the universe. A process of being able to allow yourself to feel the pain of the belief within you and release it from you without perpetrating its pain upon others. The Bible says that God is a God of mercy and understanding. Let me read this. It says, "But love your enemies and do good to them and lend to them without expecting to get anything back." This is to your enemies. This is my words to the Jews. "Then your reward will be great and you will be sons of the Most High, because He is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful." Now, that is a loving person, being kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Kindness to the ungrateful and wicked is love. Does that make sense? That certainly follows, doesn't it? All right, so that's one description of God. And then here's another. Oh, by the way, that came from Luke chapter 6. And verse 35 and 36, and I've quoted that verse a number of times previously because it's one of my favourite sayings. Deuteronomy chapter 13 and verses. Yeah, I'll read a few of these verses. This is the same God we're talking about now. It says, "If you hear it is said about one of the towns the Lord your God is giving you to live in, that wicked men have arisen among you and have led the people of their own town astray, saying, 'Let us go and worship other gods, gods you have not known,' then you must inquire, probe, and investigate it thoroughly. And if it is true that it has been proved that this detestable thing has been done among you, you must certainly put to the sword all who live in that town. Destroy it completely, both its people and its livestock. Gather all the plunder of the town into the middle of the public square and completely burn the town and all of its plunder as a whole burnt offering to your Lord, your God. It is to remain a ruin forever, never to be rebuilt." None of those condemned things shall be found in your hands, so that the Lord will turn from his fierce anger and he will show you mercy and have compassion on you and increase your numbers, as he promised in an oath to your forefathers, because you obey the Lord your God, keeping all of his commands that I am giving you today and doing what is right in his eyes. So what's that called? Now, in the Second World War, when the Nazis did that to a town, what did we do? We created a trial system called the Nuremberg Trials. Isn't that their name? And we created a trial system to find every one of those people, and we called them war crimes. People who were what? There's a term. Criminals against humanity. And yet, the Bible actually says to do exactly the same thing. How do you feel about that? On one hand, there's my words talking about God and there's real qualities. And on the other hand, in the same Bible, which, by the way, a Christian would say is all of God's word, on the other hand, we get this God that's willing to completely eradicate from existence not only the people in the town, but all the animals in the town, all the livestock in the town, everything, in order to please his own vanity, just because they don't worship him. That's the only reason. Isn't that vanity? Like, doesn't that sound like some people in some kind of governments that we've seen around in the last couple of hundred years? Yeah, just vanity, wanting everybody to agree with them. As soon as nobody does, they die. We condemn that in humans, and yet it's acceptable for God. And I put to you that it's not acceptable for God. And this is just another false thing that's in the Bible about God. And the problem I see with a book, with trusting a book that has so many false things about God, is that when you start argumenting or presenting arguments with the book, you are already basing your arguments on false premises. So to me, that's not a very logical thing to do. Why would you want to do that? Let's look at some others, shall we? Oh, by the way, I'm singling out the Bible, but the book of the Quran says almost identical things. To kill, to pillage, to completely eradicate certain people with certain beliefs from your society. Something that no self-respecting Muslim with a conscience would want to do themselves, even. Yep. So, and I can quote some of those verses if you want. I've written them down in the Quran. Here's another one. Romans 11. This is a new Bible, so I've just got a few sticky pages to get my way through. Here's some comments that Paul made about God. The depth of the riches of wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Now, they are very beautiful words, which I feel are all true. That's one aspect presented about God. That's another one that my friend John wrote through inspiration. First John 3:20, it's from. Let's do that. It says, God is greater than our hearts and he knows everything. I also agree with that. But then it also says this. So in other words, it's basically saying that God is greater than everything, knows all things, is perfect in all of his ways, is another quote from the Bible. It's saying that God never makes a mistake, never feels bad. God is greater than our hearts. And all of that is true. Then it says, so the Lord said, I will wipe out mankind whom I have created from the face of the earth, men and animals and creatures that move along the ground and birds of the air, for I am grieved that I made them. Whew. That's a pretty heavy emotion that God has, isn't it? Being grieved that he actually created. Now, if God is omniscient and all-powerful, as the religions claim, and as I personally agree with, then the logic of this, this has to be a false verse, because there is no way that God would be grieved about his creations when all of his creations are perfect. Why would he be aggrieved at a creation? He would feel no grief, because he would have known and even foreknown that many of the men might turn out to be wicked before he even created them. He would have known that by giving them the gift of free will, realizing the possibility that free will could be used negatively and therefore cause wickedness and evil. Wouldn't he have known that? So how could he then be grieved that they become that way and then want to wipe them out, which is another act of evil, in order to correct it? And yet, that is often quoted as the reason that, by the way, the context of that is the flood of Noah's day. The reason for the flood of Noah's day, according to the Bible, was that God felt sorry and grieved that he had created mankind. And he decided to not only kill mankind, but to wipe off the face of the earth animals and birds and creatures that move along the ground and the birds of the air, everything. Now, doesn't that sound like a person just in a bit of a rage? Yeah, certainly does. I think there's another verse here where I wanted to read. Ah, yes, here's another one. Genesis 8, verse 21, it says this. The Lord smelled the pleasing aroma of a sacrifice, this is, but that Noah had made of some clean animals and clean birds that he sacrificed to God, which, by the way, were already God's. So I don't know why you have to sacrifice something that was already owned and provided by God. Doesn't make much sense anyway, but let's go with it. Never again will I curse the ground because of man, even though every inclination of his heart is evil from childhood onwards. God created you with every inclination of your heart evil from childhood onwards. What chance do you have? You might as well just give up now, as far as I'm concerned, if that's the truth.
Channel 7's going to have a field day, baby.
Doesn't worry me. Let's put it in context. I know that this, you know, this presentation is going to get taken way out of context, right? And that's the way it goes. But all I'm doing is presenting some truth. That's all. The reality is that if God felt that making mankind was a mistake, then he only needs to look at himself for making the mistake. He's the creator. It's like you creating a car and you realize, oh, wow, I forgot two wheels, right? That must be somebody else's problem. I'm going to now burn the car and start again. Like, does that sound logical to you? Of course it isn't logical. And it's certainly not what an intelligent, universally intelligent being would do, is it? That makes sense. Peter, thanks. We have the mic there.
I haven't had any upbringing in the churches or anything like that, but how does an intelligent, thinking minister stand in front of a group who studied the Bible all their life and are so passionate? How do they intellectually jump over these massive contradictions and still stand there and say, you know, with the absolute passion and sincerity of their heart, this is the truth? And How do they do that?
Well, it's interesting you ask the question, Peter, because I was an intelligent thinking minister.
What happened?
Who actually did believe all of these things. And that's one of the experiences I put myself through this this life, embarrassingly so. Right? And the reality is, childhood emotions play a much bigger part on everything you accept than you can imagine. And belief systems and acceptable belief systems are easy to overlook because of different emotions that you feel. So, for example, I believed through my emotional injuries from my parents exactly the same as my father. And that is, while it was right for me to be a pacifist, that God was going to do my punishing for me. So every person who treated me badly, God would deal with at some point in the future. And that was my that was my safety. That was my, what's the word I'm looking for? My solace. And this is the problem, that many of these people teaching these things are sincere, so I'm not questioning their sincerity, but I am questioning the fact that they are not thinking or feeling with clarity. There is no logic in their thinking or feeling, which tends to suggest to me that they still have emotions that come from an unloving environment in their own life that cause them to assimilate these belief systems. Now, if we can describe it like this. If this is your soul, right, and your soul has a pristine structure, and you've got sort of like a shell around the outside of your soul that's based upon love. So, in other words, anything that enters your soul has to be loving before it can enter it. Now, if that was the case, which is the way God, in fact, originally created us, and it is the way that every child who is conceived first enters this universe, the physical universe, that's the way it is. Now, if that's the way it is, any untruth that comes towards that soul, what will happen to it? It'll just go bounce off. No effect whatsoever. Won't enter that soul. But as this, and remember, the problem we have when we first come to the earth is that we have no conscious way of determining this love. And it feels bad, but we have no conscious way of determining the difference. Consciousness grows over periods of time. So therefore, right at the time of conception, because of the undeveloped mind and the undeveloped logic that is in that child, there is no way of logically determining or separating untruth from truth. Aside from the feeling of it entering you, there's no other way of determining. So what happens is that over periods of time, the love barrier, if you like, gets broken down through this process of assimilation of the environment, assimilating the world's definition of God, the world's definition of love, and so forth. So now we have a lot of fear, which is the barrier to our soul. Now what can enter us? A false belief comes along that is based upon fear, and where does it go? Straight in without resistance. Right. And now we have a false belief that was allowed to enter our soul through the fear that is now a part of our soul. And this is why I said yesterday, you cannot become at one with God without actually feeling through your terror and your fear, because it's your terror and your fear that prevents all true beliefs from entering you. And now this fear is also a barrier to love. So when love tries to enter you, what happens? It bounces off. When truth tries to enter you, it bounces off. And this is what it is for every single person on the planet, whether they are religious or not. These emotional concepts that were created through generations past, as soon as we're conceived, begin to enter us. They are initially painful, perhaps, but they begin to grow within us because the fear just grows. The fear, we absorb the fear of our environment. And in absorbing the fear of our environment, we are automatically absorbing every single untruthful teaching of our environment as well. Automatically, it's like no resistance. So now, when I'm adult, I get out a book like this and I read concepts in the book, none of which don't appeal to me, because my fear has dictated what my soul is now open to receiving. So I can read some words here and I go, yes, I want God to come and punish the wicked. I'm not going to punish them because I'm a good person. But I want God to do it for me. That's God's right. I believe it's God's right. God's the creator. God has the will to take away life, give life, whatever. We don't question whether it's loving or not.
So is it like the seeds of those beliefs are already been planted and the environment just causes them to grow
exactly.
As we grow up?
Exactly that, Pete. Exactly. So as we're growing, because we now have this openness due to the fear that is now entered our soul from our parents most probably, but also from our environment, that has now made us predisposed to accepting fear-based teachings and also predisposed to rejecting love-based teachings at the same time.
But it must also be to filter out anything that doesn't line up with our preconceived ideas.
That's correct.
Which is all those things you've been reading out. Those statements, they just jump over those and say, oh, well, I'll skip that.
That's correct. And what happened in my own life is I had to go through experiences that confronted me fully emotionally, allowing me to see that, hang on a sec, my boys don't even talk to me. At one point, my sons didn't even speak to me, and I didn't feel like punishing them. Now, if I don't feel like punishing my own sons who wouldn't speak to me during that period of time, then surely God wouldn't punish me if I didn't speak to him. And then I started realizing my concept of love has been totally distorted by my environment. What I believe love to be is totally not what love is. And in fact, I am actually myself more loving than what I believe God to be, which is a total crazy concept, because love came from God for me to have it. So I'm actually believing that I'm more loving than God. This is the reason why a lot of people are atheists, right? And a lot of people are so-called infidels, because they look at the religious viewpoint of God and they go, wow, if that's God, I don't want to know that God. Would you? No, you wouldn't. But the problem is we do want to know that God, the God that's punishing and destroying, because we have already got this fear-based predisposition in our soul that we've absorbed from the environment that allows us to believe that concept of God rather than the true concept of God.
So how long did it take for you to unlearn all that crap?
In terms of my concept of God, it took 7 years for me in this life to unlearn all of that. Through a lot of personal experiences where I had to do a fair bit of grieving. And in particular, it was my relationship with my sons that helped me work through a lot of it, in the sense that I started to see that, you know, I wouldn't treat my sons that way, so why would God treat me that way? I actually, at one point in my life, felt that God condemned me completely. That was the point in my life where if I had died, there would have been nobody at my funeral. I might have actually rotted away in my house, actually, because nobody would have found me, and it would only be not paying the rent, which I used to pay 3 months in advance. would have been anybody would have found me.
Someone would have smelt you.
Yeah, somebody would have smelt me. And during that time, I realized that a lot of my concepts of God that I had accepted, and I always had a reasoning mind, but I had accepted because of this openness to fear, this openness to these false beliefs because of the fear that was in me. And as I released the fear more and more, I found that I could not any longer accept those false beliefs. And those false beliefs, as a result, through this emotional process, left me. So in the first century, I didn't have to go through that process. It was a much more simple process, and one day, I hope, a process that almost everyone on the planet will go through, which will be a very gentle and simple process. But unfortunately, in this day and age, how we're living, it's a very hard process because we have so much fear in us. And the fear predisposes us to false beliefs. And this is how a book can be written and compiled and accepted as God's word, even though it's clear it is not talking about the God that we know. It's not talking about the real creator who obviously created loving systems for us to live in. And if you look at everything that God has done, it's all pretty pristine, isn't it? Like, when man comes and touches it, then it gets damaged.
And it's really the same with our own soul.
It was pristine before man touched it. And then as man touched it and got into, firstly, the emotion of self-reliance and then gathered momentum from there, as that occurred, now every soul thereafter got touched or branded with that same brand, if you like, of fear. And that fear brand has enabled false religious concepts to be perpetrated as God's truth with the acceptance of billions. Billions of people. Currently, it is claimed, of course, not necessarily true, but currently is what, about 1.5 billion Christians on the planet and another 1 and something billion Muslims on the planet, all of which they're two religions that believe in a holy book that they believe is God's word. And yet the concepts of God inside of those books are completely flawed, right? So therefore, they cannot be God's word. They have to be the word of men, portrayed as God's word. And why would men do that? I can only see one motive, and that is control. And that's the case. But yeah, we have a predisposition, unfortunately, to these false beliefs. And I am not exempt from that predisposition. I had the same predisposition as yourselves. The same predisposition. In fact, for many of you, you've got less of a predisposition than I had to accept these false beliefs.
So how is it then that the people who go along to the churches and you know, speak in tongues and do all the praying and like are part of that system, how is it that they still manage to receive God's divine love when they're so kind of off the track in their whole belief system?
Well, they manage to receive... Mary, control that one. they manage to... Mary's just worried about Peter's question because he's asked it many times before. But they manage to do that because sometimes they connect to love and sometimes they don't. And eventually, they'll get to a point where they stagnate. So but whenever you have a sincere, open, earnest longing for love, you will receive it, no matter what denomination you are, what religion you are, what background you come from, what politics you have. None of that matters. It only matters that you have a sincere, open longing for God's love, and then it will enter you. It's not based on your religion. That's why many people from many different religions have received the same. But talking in tongues is not proof of receiving God. Talking in tongues is about talking with spirits or having spirits talk through you, and that's a completely different process. That's just being totally open to spirit influence, of which many of you here are in the same manner to many of the people who are in a Pentecostal church are. And that's not the same thing. However, we can all receive love from when we're in any walk of life, but that doesn't prove that the walk of life we're living is completely the truth. It only proves that in that moment we have a sincere longing for God. That's all it proves.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. And there was someone else. You want to say something there?
No, I was.
It's all right.
I was just going to say that many of our belief systems are still really up the creek as well, and yet we've received love.
Of course.
Like,
love is a receiving.
Just what you said, yeah.
Receiving divine love is a gradual process. In other words, you don't have to clear away all of your false beliefs to receive love, but eventually you will. But you don't have to initially. Like, God's not saying, you all have to be perfect and then I'll give you my love. That's not how it works. See, that's one of our false beliefs again. That's our false belief that it's only when we're perfect we get approval. It's only when we're perfect we get love. Where did we learn that false belief from? Yeah, again, but also here, by the way. So you see, a lot of society, a lot of the books created by society have been created and allowed to be perpetrated because we already have these false beliefs coming from these fear-based beliefs inside of us that cause us to have an openness and a predisposition to those false beliefs. And this is why a book can be written that millions of billions of people follow without question. That's how it can occur. But we do want a question. God, in fact, created a logical brain to a degree, because it's very much emotionally influenced. But God created a logical brain for you to question, to examine, and work out things. That's the purpose for it. Ivana?
With you saying before that, like, because I didn't grow up with a religion at all.
Yep.
And I think before you said something like, even if you didn't grow up in a religion, you can still have Christian beliefs.
Yep.
So would that be like myself as well?
Yep.
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 Okay.
Well, one of the beliefs is that God is a punishing God. That's what you used to believe, isn't it?
I think I still believe that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And where does that come from? Can you see it comes from your family? Like there is this belief in your family that if you're having pain, then you're getting punished. And if you're having punished, you must have done something wrong.
Yeah. Mm. Okay, cool.
And they are all these Christian beliefs. Now, when I say they're the Christian beliefs, they're not just the Christian beliefs. Like the Judaism religion has the same set of beliefs. The Muslim religion has the same set of beliefs, basically. And the reason why we all have the same set of beliefs is because we have that emotional openness. Before the religion even came along, before it was even created, we had an emotional openness because of the fear of our parents and the damage that did to our soul. We have an emotional openness and predisposition to accepting fear-based beliefs. Yep. If we go... And then to David.
My question's around the Middle Eastern law of karma.
Mm-hmm.
And I went through a phase in my life where I invested a lot of faith in that law because I was receiving a lot of anger from someone and chose to, you know, follow the path of truth and peace. And
So your belief of karma was?
That I wouldn't fight back, I'd just choose my path and that karma would go and sort things out for me.
How about this? I put it this, what goes around comes around.
That's right. Because I thought, well, okay, I'm surrendering to this, so I'm going to allow it to continue, so I'm not going to fight. And I thought, and if I just follow my truth and choose the peaceful option, then karma will come back. I was just really struggling with it, big time.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
But I had a lot of faith in that
karma. Because it feels unjust and unpleasant while you're going through it all.
Yeah, and you have no control.
Yeah.
You're not taking any control of it.
You're also not seeing that it's a law of attraction upon your own soul based on your own soul's unhealed emotion. You're not sort of seeing that you're continually creating it either.
No, that's right. So I guess now in reflection, I sort of think, is karma like a misinterpretation of the soul's law of attraction? Because really...
It's a misinterpretation of what you sow, you reap, in the sense that it's a punishment-based interpretation of that law. The truth is that what you sow, you will reap. But often we imply that to others and not ourselves. So what you sow, you will reap. What I sow, you will reap too. That's what we do, right?
Well, I also understood that a lot of it was my karma and I was just I thought, okay, I'm just going to take it and deal with it.
But not understanding the underlying, that you could release the underlying cause. Yeah. And this is where I feel a lot of even the New Age philosophies, while some of them are improvements on different things, some of them actually help you skip over personal responsibility. They help you skip over also developing in love and working through your own emotional injuries. They help you intellectualize the process so that you can avoid the emotion. So you start to become no longer honest about your own emotional feelings about what's happening. So the reality is the majority of you still at times when you're being attacked, you feel this is unfair, this is unjust, you feel like attacking back, you feel like defending yourself. All of those emotions are present, right? I'm suggesting to you when you receive God's love more, none of those emotions will be present. You won't feel any of those things.
So in effect, there's evidence for karma. People see it, but really all it is that person's law of attraction came back to them, and I stood back and thought, oh, that's karma.
Yeah. So we really call it a karma, and karma is this principle of what you sow, you reap, what goes around, comes around, does occur to a degree. But unfortunately, we have a lot of emotional investment in it. We want what goes around to come around to the people who did it to us. We don't want what goes around to come around to what we did to others. Right? And so we are often very hypocritical in the way in which we apply a law. God is not hypocritical. The law applies across the board, without partiality, with equality. But when we apply the law, we often do it with partiality and no equality. Yeah. So I was talking to a group of spirits a few weeks ago. It was an interesting conversation, and I think this one might be able to put it on the net. I think it might already be there. It was the one where we were talking to those three men, remember, where you and Jody and Natalie were channeling, and I was talking to three men at the same time. There were a group of men in the spirit world, and they were in a rage with women and saying that it was their right to oppress women. You know, they had all these beliefs about that. They believed with all their heart that women were animals in the spirit world, and many of you ladies would have been very hard-pressed to do the channeling without getting upset. And it was a credit to the three women who were present doing the channeling for these men that they could stay in the space of accurately reflecting the emotions of the men involved. And I think I have placed it on the net, have I? Yeah, I think I have. It's worth listening to anyway. And it was an interesting discussion because they believed that the law that applied to them didn't apply to women because women were lesser. Women were just animals anyway. The laws that applied to animals applied to women.
So even if, like, let's say I was never outwardly angry, if I had a lot of anger within me that I was suppressing, then I could attract a person into my life that would project a lot of anger at me. Is that right?
No, it's more likely that fear in you would attract anger from another person.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. You see, a lot of people, a lot of New Age philosophy goes, oh, you're getting angry because that's the anger in you. No, the emotions have to be sympathetic for it to be occurring. So the reality is, usually when we're receiving anger, it's because of our openness to receiving anger, which means that we are afraid of that kind of person who's giving us the anger generally. We are open to receiving it. So if a woman's angry with us all the time, then we know we're open to receiving a woman's anger. We think it's okay. If a man's angry with us all the time, then we're open to receiving a man's anger. The reality, though, is if we feel our emotions, we'd probably notice that we feel quite open to receiving anger from that person and not this person, and we'd quickly identify what gender it is and we'd work through the emotion.
Great, thanks.
But let's talk about some more about God. So does everyone understand how our soul becomes predisposed to false beliefs about love and about God and about truth? Yeah? It's pretty simple, isn't it, really, as how it becomes predisposed. David, you've got a question?
I'm not sure how it is for anyone else, but with regards to how our emotional set from our parents we project on God, and in regards to God and love, I can't quite draw the connection for myself. When things are going well, when I've been processing well, I feel God, I feel closer to God, and everything's great. But when things are tough and when I really need God, so to speak, or need God's help, God seems the furthest away.
Okay, so let's look at this emotionally. When I need God, many of you feel this, right? When I need God, God goes AWOL. Absent without leave. Right? This is a very common thing that happens inside of us. Now, let's see what we begin with always is that we begin with the assumption that God's not loving still. And when we begin with that assumption, we're assuming God's gone AWOL. We're assuming that when I need God, God's not there. God's only there when I don't need God. We're assuming that that's the truth. The reality is that actually God is there more when you need God than not. However, usually when we have a feeling of I need God, there is usually an underlying emotion or condition or belief which is false, which has to be confronted. And the only way that this is going to be confronted is if you feel like God's not there. Do you understand? That's the only way you're going to get into this emotion. So God's right there, but God can't give you the emotions that you think you want while those emotions are based on some addiction to some false belief within you. And so therefore, God is right there saying, come on, David, come on, David. I'm right here. You just got to believe that. You just got to trust that instead of feeling it, because you can't feel it at the moment because of the emotion you have. Just feel this emotion, because this emotion is blocking you from having a closer relationship with me. That's really what God's saying in that particular example. And unfortunately, for many of us, we then think the opposite of that. We think, oh, God's gone missing somehow. God's not there anymore. And then we even feel a lack of faith. We don't believe that God's with us anymore. And we even get angry and upset that God's not with us. Why are you only with us when we're, you know, when we're connected to you? Why are you not with us when we're not connected to you? Not understanding that it's something within our own soul that causes the disconnection, not God's. You see, we assume it's something in God's soul that causes the connection because we believe in a punishing God. Because if we didn't believe in a punishing God, we wouldn't automatically assume that when we can't feel God, that it's something to do with God being upset or something. We wouldn't automatically assume that. We would assume that it has to be something within ourselves, wouldn't we? The fact that we assume that it's God that's gone missing rather than ourselves that's gone missing, right, tells us that we have a false belief about God that needs correction, and it needs correction, and if it doesn't get correction, then it's going to prevent us from getting closer to God. Because in the end, when we are at one with God, we will not only have God's beliefs about ourselves. To be at one with God, you must believe what God believes about you. But also, you will have God's beliefs about God. And all of those beliefs have to be confronted to become at one with God. And if one of those beliefs is, anytime I'm in trouble, you leave me, that's a false belief. Because God doesn't leave you in that time. There's something else going on instead.
So I could use the trust that I have when I feel God is there to trust that even though I don't feel God there, that God is there and can help me through this
exactly
belief.
Exactly. And that there is just an emotion in you that prevents you from feeling God at that moment, that God is trying to help you address so that you can feel God better. Yeah. See, we don't trust that God is good, do we? What is it in the Arabic, Allah Akbar? Allah Akbar, God is good. We don't believe God is good. Really? We believe God's punishing, cruel, violent. The other things we believe, because that's what our parents, through their fear, predisposed us to believing.
Right? No, I don't believe that God could love me.
Exactly. You don't believe God is good, because God would love all of her children. So why wouldn't she love you? And because we don't believe God loves us, we believe there must be something either wrong with us, but God created everything right with us, so that doesn't make much sense. And then we believe there must be something wrong with God. Now, some of us prefer that it has to be something wrong with God, and others of us prefer that it must be something wrong with us. And this is where all these predispositions towards the false beliefs of you are sinners, all of you, and you are born sinners, and you'll die sinners. What did I say just earlier? Where did that come from? Genesis, wasn't it? 6, verse 7, was it? Oh, yeah, that's right. Genesis 8, 21, wasn't it? Never again shall I curse the ground because of man, even though every inclination of his heart is evil from childhood. You see, we accept that belief because we believe that about ourselves already. By the time we get to 2 years of age, most of us already believe that. Because most of us have been taught that by our parents. You evil little, you know, and most of the time a swear word or two accompanies it. What did you do that for? What's wrong with you? There's something wrong with you inside of you. It's got nothing to do with the parent, of course, they say. But, you know, it's the same principle, isn't it? Blaming the child for the parent's rage and then causing the child to feel that it's evil when it wasn't. And so we've grown up with these emotions, feeling these things, believing this is God's opinion of us, and we've got to accept it. The whole principle that you all need to be ransomed from your sin is based on the fact that you're all evil and terrible and need to be condemned. Another field day with that statement. The reality is God is not like this. God is not the God that we have come to accept him to be. And it's because we have come to accept God to be this cruel, punishing, vindictive, petty being that we don't want to connect with her. But God's not like that. God is totally different to that. We need to allow ourselves to see the truth of that. Let's have a look at another one. This one is in James, the first book of James. James is in the New Testament, by the way, again. This one's in verse 13. Oh, let's start at verse 12. It says, "Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. When tempted, no one should say, 'God is tempting me,' for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he, by his own evil desire, is dragged away and enticed. Then, after the desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death." Now, that is the truth. The truth is that God doesn't tempt us. God is not trying to test us or test us with evil, but rather our own desires that are inside of us, because we have the emotional predisposition to those desires because of the fear that we have, causes us to then conceive sin. We then go ahead and do what we desire, which is often in the wrong direction. And that's what causes our pain and eventually even our physical body's death. The reality is many of us should be living much longer than we're currently living, but we can't because of the desire that was out of harmony with love, that gave birth to the sin that was out of harmony with love, that ended up with the destruction of our own physical body as a result. It's a course of action that we took that resulted in our own death. And God isn't tempting us or with evil or anything like that. So that is a truth. But let's look at... The Koran says a similar thing in one place, and then in another place, in 2 verses 2 to 7, it says, "Allah keeps people in darkness and prolongs the darkness." Totally the opposite statement. Let's look at this one. This one was meant to have been said by me. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 13. The Lord's Prayer, the last line of it says... For anybody who remembers their time in church, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." All right. So that implies that God leads us into temptation and we have to pray that he doesn't. Does it not? So on one verse it says that God doesn't lead us by anything that's evil. And then the other verse, said to be my own verse, says that God does lead us into temptation, then we have to pray to God so that God doesn't lead us into temptation. No wonder people are confused, hey? Now, for this reason, many people coin the term that God tests me. You've heard of that? It's total crap. God never tests you. We are often put to the test by the evil that surrounds us. It's the evil that tests us, actually, when you think about it. Without the evil, all of us would find it very much less difficult to live a loving life. But because of the evil that surrounds us and the fear-based propositions that we have, not only on the earth, but a lot of spirits who are in an evil state too, because that evil surrounds us, it is now very difficult for us to live a love-based life. God is not testing you, but these other people want you to get into an unloving space. They are the ones who are testing you, because the reality is that anybody who is loving would never design a test for you. They would always be trying to assist you to do what is good. That's the reality. And God is good. Therefore, God is not designing a system to test you. But there are many, many dark spirits and people on earth who are totally willing to test you and test your resolve towards truth, test your resolve to love. But they are not and do not have anything to do with God. Joy?
Can we truly be tested, though, by a dark spirit or a dark person unless we have something in us? So if we were strong in our love?
You're exactly right. There's no way that it would even feel to be a test unless there was something inside of myself that was fear-based rather than love-based that could be tested. So the law that operates, which is the law of attraction, to bring this evil person into my life that allows the test, is operating because of an emotion inside of myself. Where did it come from, again, the emotion inside of myself? From my environment and my parents and what I grew up with. So it's not even my fault that it's happening, but I do need to address it. I do need to do something with it. Yeah.
Just a little bit of trivia.
Yep.
Before we met you and we calibrated everything we ever read.
Yep.
The Bible calibrates around 650, the Quran around 800.
So 650 for the Bible?
Yeah.
The Quran around 800?
Now, we would never read anything that calibrated in the 600s.
Yeah.
And that's because it's got so many discrepancies.
Yeah.
So they balance each other out.
So this is when you were doing, like,
kinesiology
testing on them, yeah?
And then what we... And so...
Can I suggest that some of your testing about the Bible was about your emotions as well, though?
Right.
Yep. And I would actually put them both lower than that on the scale of truth. But yep.
And so any of the New Age literary stuff like Eckhart Tolle...
Did you ever test the New Testament versus the Old Testament?
Yes, we did, and we got a difference. And actually, there are some things you can do with taking stuff out of the Bible, and it comes up to about 800, like the Quran.
Yeah, exactly. So different things come in, go out, and all of a sudden things are different. Yeah.
And so things like Eckhart Tolle and David Hawkins calibrate in the 800s and 900s.
Yep.
And then when we started to calibrate your work, your presentations, we realised that anything that was divine truth and divine love calibrates over 1,000.
Always.
Always. And now most of the talks are up around the 1,500.
Yeah, that's correct. And will be greater as we go along, as we present more and more things and myself and Mary get into more truth ourselves.
Yeah, it'll be interesting because we actually haven't calibrated any of this year's work.
Mm. Yeah. Let's read another one, shall we? From the lovely Bible that we have. One day the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. This Satan, by the way, God created to test you. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming through the earth and going to and fro in it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." And Satan says, "Does Job fear God for nothing?" Satan replied, "Have you not put a hedge around him and has his house and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands, so that these flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well then. Everything he has is in your hands, but on the man himself do not lay a finger." And then Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. You know what happened next? The first thing Satan did, so-called, he arranged for the attack of his entire family. They put every single servant to death. And then he arranged another attack of the entire family, and all of his livestock was destroyed. And then he arranged another attack where a wind came from the desert and collapsed on the house while all of his children were in it. And they all died. And only him and his wife survived. This is a very loving God that we have arranged for the test of Job. Right? I put to you that the test of Job never occurred by God. Never occurred by God. And the Bible doesn't say it does. The Bible says that Satan did it. But I put to you that according to the Bible, God allowed Satan to do it. And that's not the case either. Like, there is no Satan, so you can't allow somebody who doesn't exist to do something. Does that make sense? Now, that, of course, is going to challenge many people with false beliefs, is it not? That there is no Satan. It's a huge concept that we hold on to in Christian faith and in other faiths too, that there is a Satan. So that's not true either. But getting back to the issue with God, God does not allow or condone or accept anything bad that happens to you as if it was his purpose. Because none of it needs to happen. And the reality is that it does happen because of not only our own choices, but the choices of the evil choices and the fear-based choices of those around us. That's why it happens. And those choices all came from fear that has entered our soul, that it's allowed us to have a predisposition to treating other people badly. That's where it all comes from, not from God. But again, this world's definition of God gets put upon us, and we end up with this belief system that is so entwined with false beliefs about God that none of us want to know God. We end up wanting to reject God and push God away from us because of all these belief systems. And that's the terrible, unfortunate truth of a lot of these things. Now, I could go on for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours and hours quoting all of these different verses to you about God's nature. But what I'm trying to illustrate to you, and the point of this particular discussion about the world's definition of God, is this. Firstly, the world is full of contradiction. About God. That is a statement of truth. Any atheist would probably agree with me that the world is full of contradictions about God. Number two, these beliefs are allowed to enter the soul, to enter the soul. Because of fear in the soul. It's the fear in our soul that allows false beliefs about God to enter our soul and then for us to live the rest of our life like that. And I'm not immune to the control of fear. While fear is within me, I am going to absorb those beliefs. My own personal life has been like that. I accepted completely this as God's word at one point in my life. And the reason why I accepted the Bible as God's word is because I had a predisposition, because of the fear that was in my soul, to accepting fear-based beliefs and to accepting unloving belief systems. And I came up with all intellectual justifications. I heard many of them, and I came up with many of my own in order to maintain those belief systems rather than deal with the fear that was in my soul. And then God, in her infinite wisdom and love, took me through a process. A process that begins through the law of attraction, that is a law that God made to expose truth to us. And God took me through this process that I became willing eventually to engage. And once I became willing to engage that process eventually, the fear in my soul got exposed. And then I worked through this fear, physically worked through it, went through lots of different emotions of fear and came out the other end. And when I came out the other end, no longer could these false beliefs, these world's definition of God, enter me anymore. And the same thing can happen to you if you deal with your fear. If you work through your fear. Chris, thanks.
Hey, how does it work with that belief that we'll be left behind when Jesus comes?
Sorry, say that again.
That belief, that Christian belief of being left behind.
And you mean
That you're going to take us all.
With the rapture.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is a belief based around that some of us are more acceptable than others, and it's based on what we do, not on what we feel. It's a belief that is perpetrated by this fact that if you do the right thing, you will be rewarded. And if you don't do the right thing, you won't be. And that belief is very prevalent, isn't it, in human society? We have to do the right thing, and if we don't do the right thing, we get punished. If we do the right thing, we get rewarded. So it's like the carrot and the stick. So you could basically say the whole belief system entered the Bible through this principle of the carrot and the stick that all of us have inbuilt because of the fear-based belief systems that we have.
Yeah, for me it was just be a good little boy and sit and be quiet in church.
Exactly.
And I could feel it from my mum all the time, this real big like, oh, stay here, the fire and brimstone and all that shit. And,
exactly. Yeah. And so fear perpetrates a false belief entering us, and then we become so attached to it, we can't give it up. I've been a good little boy. When's my reward? You see, it's gotten to this place that there is no reward in just being a good boy. We have to have some kind of additional reward. There's no reward in itself, just being good. We have to have some kind of external thing occur that makes it better.
Yeah, I had it just before. It was preventing me from even going to the toilet. I was so like, all these voices were saying like, oh.
Yeah, there's a lot of spirits in the room, who are Christian-based spirits in particular, who are very upset with almost everything I'm saying today. So a lot of you are getting influenced by those, and that's to be understood. But we'll hopefully talk to them over the coming few weeks, and hopefully we'll get to explain to them the truths about these particular things. But if you can understand that these couple of things from our discussion, that the world is full of contradictions about God. It's no wonder most of the world's confused about even whether God exists or not, because we're full of contradictions about God. And then these contradicting beliefs are allowed to enter the soul because of our fear predisposing our soul to the belief entering it. That is the reason why these beliefs enter our soul. And then thirdly, we need God's truth and God's love to remove all fear-based beliefs. Without the assistance of God's truth and God's love entering our soul, it's going to be very difficult for us to determine what is a fear-based belief and what is a truth. And it's only by having truth confront the fear and having love confront all of the unworthiness and grief within us that we can actually remove these fear-based beliefs from ourselves. And the world's definition of God, unfortunately, until that time, is going to have its little tentacles into us in every aspect of our life. And this is what we need to understand. That even right now, the majority of us still have these tentacles affecting our relationship with God. In the past, when I've given a talk about relationship with God, there has usually been less people at one of those talks than any other talk, with the exception of parenting talks, which is interesting, because the two issues are related. Parenting talks and God, God being our parent, is very much related, of course. I find it so fascinating because one is linked to the other, inseparably so, it seems sometimes. And yet, if we understand that it's because we are imposing the parental belief systems on God that we are now susceptible to all of these fear-based beliefs that about God that are not true. And, you know, even our desire to punish ourselves comes from some of these beliefs. Our desire to punish others comes from some of these beliefs. Our desire or our belief that we can't cope with emotion comes from these beliefs. Our belief that God didn't create us perfect comes from these beliefs. Like that, there are so many beliefs. If you read the true Lord's Prayer that we've provided you on the back of the DVDs, if you think of that prayer, many of those things that are listed confront the beliefs that are all about God. You know, my Father who is in the heaven, I recognize that you are all holy and loving and merciful. Most of us don't even feel that. We feel that God is loving and merciful sometimes and punishing other times. And that I am your child, not the subservient, sinful, and depraved creature that the false teachers would have me believe. Can you see? Like, you read a verse like in Genesis 8:21, of course you're going to believe that you've got God telling you you're a sinful, depraved creature from the time of your birth onward. So there's nothing else to believe, is there? I just would like to read the prayer. I know that I am the greatest of your creations. How many of us know that? Really? We don't know that. We think we're not the greatest of God's creations. You know, half the time we think of ourselves that we're mongrels. So, or even worse. And the most wonderful of all of your handiworks, the object of your great soul's love and tenderest care. Now, how many of us believe that God actually cares for us tenderly all the time? It was like when David asked that question, wasn't it, about about, you know, I feel like when I need God, God's deserted me. This is what we really believe most of the time, that God deserts us. But in the prayer, it's saying that God has the tenderest care for us. I know that your will is that I become at one with you and partake of your great love, which you have bestowed upon me through your mercy, and desire that I become in truth your child through love, and not through the sacrifice and death of any of your creatures. I pray that you will open up my soul to the inflowing of your love, and that then will come to me your Holy Spirit to bring into my soul this, your divine love, in great abundance, until my soul is transformed into the very essence of yourself, and that there will come to me faith, such faith as will cause me to realize that I am truly your child, and at one with you in very substance, not in image only. Most of us don't have that kind of faith yet, do we? That we even have the possibility of becoming at one with God. I still hear many of you saying things like, oh, yes, I'm full of fear, but I probably will be for the rest of my life. Why would you believe such a false thing? You're not going to be full of fear for the rest of your life if you release your fear. Many of you feel, I'm probably never going to become at one with God while I'm on earth. Why would you believe that's a false thing? The possibility is for you to have become at one with God while you're on earth. Why would you believe anything else? Because we just don't have the faith. And unfortunately, because we don't have faith, we then don't carry out what we need to carry out to stop blocking God from entering us, stop blocking God's love from entering us. So we are unwilling to confront the emotions within us because of that lack of faith. Let me have such faith that will cause me to know, not just think, but know that you are my Father and the bestower of every good and perfect gift, and that only I myself can prevent your love from changing me from the mortal to the immortal. We still have this tendency to go down the track of thinking that, no, God's punishing somehow, or God's withdrawing her love from us somehow, or God's trying to slow us down, or God's not really with us at the time God is with us, or that God doesn't want us to become immortal as she is, or that God doesn't give us every good gift and every perfect present. We feel that when we ask for love, that God's going to give us a snake instead. But even it's only the cruelest of humankind that would do that, and yet we attribute that to God too. Let me never cease to realize that your love is waiting for each and all of us, and that when I come to you in faith and earnest aspiration, your love will never be withheld from me. And this gets back to the question you asked Peter, like, if it feels like faith is being withheld from me, that is just not true. Faith is, love is never withheld from us. God's love is never withheld. It's only we ourselves that can prevent its entry. So if it's not entering us, we need to look at ourselves, not to God. We need to look at what blockages we have within ourselves and do it in a way where we realize that we are the greatest of God's creation, not the worst of it, and we have a capacity to change. Keep me in the shadow of your love every hour and moment of my life, and help me to overcome all the temptations of the flesh and the influence of the powers of the evil ones who so constantly surround me and endeavor to turn my thoughts away from you to the allurements and pleasures of the world. So you see, the prayer actually defines who tests us. It's got nothing to do with God. It's got everything to do with the evil that surrounds us and our own desires that are imperfect in nature because of the fear that's already entered us. And then, I thank you for your love and the privilege of receiving it, and I believe that you are my Father, the loving Father who smiles upon me in my weakness and is always ready to help me and take me into your arms of love. When your mum and dad saw that you were weak, what did they do? Did they smile upon you in your weakness? When people today see that you're weak, what do? They turn up the volume of the pressure, don't they, generally? They want you to be in a different place, generally. But God looks upon our weakness and loves us still and is just waiting for us to want to have the earnest desire to correct any weakness. And it finishes by saying, I pray this with all the earnestness and sincere longings of my soul, and trusting in your love, give you all the glory and honor and love that my finite soul can give. You see, part of the reason why I've had this discussion with you this weekend about love, you know, yesterday the world's definition of love and today the world's definition of God, is because we still don't trust much yet. We don't trust love and we don't trust God. And we need to understand the reasons why we don't. The reasons why we don't is because we've assimilated and imbibed the world's belief systems about love, and we've assimilated and imbibed the world's belief systems about God. And so it's gotten to this point now where we can't trust God or love in our lives, and we don't trust the process that God wants us to follow to get closer to Him. We feel resistive to it often. And what we wanted to do over the coming months, when we get the opportunities, is to talk more with you about your relationship with God and your feelings of love that come from within you, and help you come to trust love more as being the most powerful substance in the universe, the most powerful feeling in the universe. And we want to also help you come to see that your father and mother, your true father and mother, not the ones that are on earth, but your true parent, God, loves you dearly and with passion. And she wants you to have this close relationship with her if that is your desire, if that's what you long for. You don't have to long for it. She's not saying you have to, but if it is your desire, she wants you to come to understand that she is a loving God, and she has loving desires for you and has these plans for you, for your soul, that you at this point in time cannot imagine. You can't imagine because you've yet to experience them. So you cannot even conceive what the possibilities are, even on this earth. And so what we'd like to do is encourage you to start confronting within yourself the world's definition of things compared to God's definition of things. And what we'd like to do is encourage you to stop accepting the world's definition of things and start to deal with the fears and terrors within you that allow you to accept the world's definition of things and that block you from God's definition of things. And in particular, start accepting God's definition of herself and God's definition of love. And if you do that, you are going to have far more joy in your life on a day-to-day basis than many of you are currently experiencing. Does that make sense to everyone? Well, I'd like to leave the discussion there if I could. It's fairly late and we were meant to finish around 3:30 or so, so we're already over time. Hopefully you've enjoyed yourself this weekend. Do we have any questions of a basic nature not related to the discussion? Again, we'd like to thank you for your time, guys, and we look forward to catching up with you sometime over the next couple of months on those things. Yeah, thank you.
Can we just thank Lena and Igor and the people who've been helping out with the filming as
filming
well,
and also as well as the event team for setting up the event this weekend,
cleaning up
after us. Thank you for your time again this weekend, guys, and we'll catch you next time.